February 6th, 1978, started out as just another Monday. But by midday, our roadways were at a standstill. The blizzard of 1978 was upon us. In 1978, Jimmy Carter was president. The Deer Hunter won 5 Academy Awards.
I love you, baby!
And the TV series The Incredible Hulk captivated American audiences. Serial killer Ted Bundy was finally captured in Florida. And Egyptian President Anwar Sadat, along with Israeli Prime Minister Menachem Begin, won the Nobel Peace Prize.
Anybody wants to get out of here.
In Guyana, Jim Jones led his People's Temple cult in a mass murder-suicide that claims 918 lives, including over 270 children. It was also the year of platform shoes. Gold and avocado green, macrame, disco dancing, and bell-bottom pants. On the Billboard charts, the Bee Gees had 3 of the top 10 songs, and their brother, Andy Gibb, had 2. And for 3 straight days, Mother Nature seized control over Connecticut as automobile, air and rail traffic were shut down and bustling businesses went dark. The blizzard of 78, Storm Larry, brought up to 30 inches of snow, bone-chilling temperatures, poor visibility, wind gusts of up to 70 miles per hour, and snowdrifts as high as 16 feet. Although weather forecasting technology had improved dramatically in the 1970s,
very windy day.
Meteorologists still had a reputation for being inaccurate, and the public was skeptical about their forecasting abilities.
Forecasting in those days was not the more precise science that it is today. And when people woke up and didn't see the snow, they got it wrong again.
When snow failed to arrive in the pre-dawn hours of February 6th, many locals thought it was just another false weather prediction. So they went to work and school as normal.
The forecast, with all of its limitations, was only off by 5 or 6 hours. Well, by midday that day, the snow started coming down at 1 inch an hour, and in some parts of New England, 4 inches an hour. And by that afternoon, if you weren't home, you weren't going home.
Because that's when the gridlock started. There was no all-wheel drive, very little front-wheel drive, and very little four-wheel drive. So it was a nightmare if you got out of work late.
What is classic with these storms is they slow down and develop secondary centers of action, as this storm did. It takes longer for everything to really come together. So folks that were in central Connecticut, in the Hartford area, or in eastern Connecticut, didn't see the snow come so early. And so folks went off to work. And they went in their cars, and they clogged the roads, and the schools were open. But then the schools had to close early, and the businesses had to close early. But at that point, we're talking now, Monday afternoon, the whole state was shut down by the blizzard.
By midday, businesses started letting their employees leave work, and schools began shutting down, but it was too late. The storm was already in full force.
The wind was howling. I mean, it was drifting big time. It was snowing sideways. The roads were really drifted over as fast as cars could go through. They had said on the Hilton forecast that it might stop or change to rain, and then I filmed the next morning when it's still snowing.
The snow was so deep, I could not distinguish where the road was. It was that bad.
I proceed to exit 4. We have 2 16-wheelers jackknifed.
I don't think I've ever driven in a storm of that nature. Tractor trailer trucks on their side. I saw just the trailers left.
We're gonna need tow trucks. Immediate response, please.
It was like skeletons along the way. I'd never seen anything like that.
The blizzard of 78 impacted not only Connecticut, but all of New England. These photos from the Providence Journal show traffic at a standstill on Interstate 95 through Providence. And this Pulitzer Prize-winning photo taken by Kevin Cole shows cars stranded in deep snow on Route 128 outside of Boston.
I've interviewed a number of people who were in those cars, and they said it felt like the end of the world because, one, they weren't prepared for this, and two, they didn't know if help was ever coming. They had sat in their cars through the afternoon, and now it's into the night, and these wind gusts are shaking the cars. So some people are afraid to get out of their cars, and others are wondering, what about the carbon monoxide? So at least they're going out to their tail of the car and getting that tailpipe free of snow. The jackpot area in terms of snowfall amount was right on the Connecticut, Rhode Island, Massachusetts border. That area got approximately 4 feet of snow.
Arriving at the time of a new moon, the blizzard of 78 produced high tides and hurricane winds all along the New England coast.
The damage that occurred along the shoreline, particularly east-facing shoreline, was tremendous. Many homes were drawn by the tide into the sea.
One Coast Guard captain who I spoke to was out in the storm on a large cutter. He said his anemometer that measures the wind speed was blown off the cutter at 120 miles per hour.
This beach parking lot and bathhouse along the Cape Cod National Seashore was wiped out by the storm. Back at home, news crews were working around the clock to cover the storm.
For me, it was a highlight of my career to cover such a huge story. It was not only the storm of the century for me, it was the story of the century. Never having seen a storm before it, that big, not snow.
The storm has the characteristics of a classic.
Effective at 10 o'clock tonight, I am ordering that all roads and highways...
In those days, television was serving the public in a way that, on rare occasion, you get to do that.
We're reaching the peak right now of Connecticut's latest snowstorm.
It was really before cable, for many people before remote. Your local television station was a primary source of information, along with a good local radio station.
The National Weather Service has issued a winter storm watch for all of Connecticut.
We were trying to show people what was happening. We were becoming the medium for the officials to go on the air and make statements, including the governor.
And the question was one of equity.
And it was the kind of the beginning of the live era. I mean, we had videotape cameras, we had microwave capability, and we had a truck or two. But it wasn't like today where you can go live just about anywhere, even if it's with a cell phone.
I lost what you said because of the noise of the plow. Could you repeat the last part of that?
Where television to me was really standing tall, and we didn't have to worry about budgets. It was do whatever it takes. And that's also very exciting. I mean, how many times in a job does somebody say, just do whatever it takes, don't worry about the money?
During the late 1970s, new computer products were available through the National Weather Service. But at times, even the forecasters were having trouble trusting these models.
We had computer products back in the late 1940s, but it was in the 70s when they began to develop a certain level of sophistication. And the new computer model that was projecting this was fairly consistent in its output. Very few people were using it at the time because it was brand new. And there was some question whether or not it would be valid whatsoever. But to me, it appeared very reasonable. So I came into the office, the Weather Center, on Saturday, and I had my daughter's Snoopy bag. And I had it packed with clothes, and I told my wife and I told my girls, I said, you know what? I think I'm going to be in the office for a few days. This thing is big, very big.
By mid-afternoon, thousands of people were stuck on the roadways all across New England, including Connecticut Governor Ella Grasso.
Ella Grasso had been giving speeches in different towns during the morning of February 7th, and she was coming back to the Capitol, and she realized that the snow was coming down so heavily by that point in the day that we were reaching a crisis level.
We knew we were going to get whacked. The staff had begun ramping up the Emergency Operations Center at the State Armory to make sure that when this thing did hit, we were ready to basically set up over there and do whatever had to be done.
She was coming into Hartford on Farmington Avenue. Her state car got stuck.
She got out of the car and walked halfway down the avenue and then cut through to the armory.
If you knew Ella Grasso, you knew she was extremely impatient, and she was ready to go to the armory and start directing snow removal operations. So there's Ella Grasso in her snow boots and in her coat, and she's trudging down Farmington Avenue. And meanwhile, cars are stopped everywhere. No one could get through.
It was just a parking lot of cars in both directions. And as I was looking out my windshield, wipers going like crazy, I saw this woman walking down the center of Farmington Avenue all by herself. And I'm looking, and as she's getting closer, I'm saying to myself, that looks like Governor Grasso. That looks exactly like Governor Grasso.
So she was knocking on the windows of the cars, people were waving at her, and she was in her take charge mode.
So I rolled down my window, and I was going to say something to her, simple like, hello, Governor, or something of that nature. And then I thought to myself, if it's not Governor Grasso, she's probably not going to appreciate that type of a comment. I thought, maybe I just better keep my mouth shut.
All of a sudden, this apparition appeared in the doorway with a hat that shouldn't have happened and a big, heavy coat and icicles hanging off of her. It was the governor.
The blizzard of 78 became a defining moment for Governor Grasso. When she won election in 1974,
Ella T. Grasso,
she inherited a huge budget deficit.
She immediately had to start cutting the state budget. She cut back the hours of state employees, and it was a very difficult time for her. And her popularity going into 1978 was at its lowest point.
There is no other alternative than to dismiss those workers who continue this illegal strike.
Also still fresh in her memory was the impact of her predecessor's actions during another major snowstorm.
She knew that Tom Mescal had been sharply criticized for being out of state. He didn't arrive until more than a day after the snow had been cleared. So she was adamant that as soon as the snow started, that she would be taking care of all of the consequences of the storm.
During the winter of 1978, Connecticut experienced several major snowstorms before Storm Larry hit.
Suffice it to say, we'd had enough snowstorms here in Connecticut. The snow was beginning to pile up on the highways, and they'd push it to the side. And then, whoops, here comes another snowstorm.
On January 18th, 1978, just 3 weeks before the blizzard of 78, the roof of the Hartford Civic Center collapsed.
Under the pressure of tons of wet snow, the roof of the three-year-old Coliseum, centerpiece of a revitalized downtown, had let go, leaving city officials trying to cope with the devastation.
It might have been the largest disaster in U.S. history, if not for the luck of timing. The 1,400-ton, two-and-a-half-acre roof of the Hartford Civic Center, covered by a blanket of snow and ice, suddenly collapsed, crushing the majority of seats below. Fortunately, the collapse injured no one. But just hours before, thousands of people had gathered at the arena to watch a UConn basketball game. The Civic Center was less than 3 years old when the roof collapsed. With its special computer-analyzed space frame design, it was meant to equally balance the load so that lighter and cheaper material could be used.
The fact that that Civic Center roof collapsed like it did in the middle of the night got everybody's attention. Snow acts kind of like a sponge, and it just was soaking up the water, and it wasn't running off in the gutters. It was just soaking up in that snowpack.
With piles of debris still scattered around the Civic Center when the storm hit, an already challenging snow removal process became further complicated.
I remember going home at night and watching these big front end loaders scooping up huge amounts of snow, dumping it in the dump trucks, and they were just lined up one after another, pulling out of downtown Hartford and dumping it in the Connecticut River.
I believe in the Norwich area, some guy had written out in the snow, "Help Ella." And that became one of the famous pictures in the history of that blizzard.
We started walking in a line. I think we drew the H first. We drew the H and the help first, kind of a straight line. And then we walked back and we, you know, started measuring in our minds, okay, we had to go this far to create this letter. There was a lot of discussion at the time with all the snow and how chaotic everything was. The town and perhaps even the region wasn't ready for a snowstorm like that. And whether it was justified or not, the governor was taking some criticism for that. And as a 12-year-old, I was hearing that from adults in my life at the time. And so my buddy Dean and I were out on the cove and down where I lived in the Trading Cove area. And we just kind of came up with this idea. Later on, we had heard that the governor had seen it the same day that we had tramped it out in the snow from a helicopter when she was touring the region. It was in the paper the next day, and our names were underneath the caption as the ones that had done it. It was kind of fun at the time.
At the time of the blizzard, Governor Grasso was being challenged in an upcoming primary by her Lieutenant Governor, Robert Killian.
The people of the state of Connecticut were anxious.
And Mr. Killian was trying his best to be part of this Save the State operation, and she wasn't having any of that. And at one point, one of the reporters asked the governor, "Governor, is there something that the Lieutenant Governor could do?" And she said, "Oh, is he here? He could make some coffee."
This change.
By the time the storm ended, the public believed it had not just a politician, but a proactive, compassionate woman as governor. Her popularity soared, and letters of thanks poured in from around the state. Grasso's new image as Mother Ella helped her easily win re-election in 1978. Defeating Republican challenger Ronald Saracen by more than 190,000 votes. Her new lieutenant governor was William O'Neill.
That you will faithfully discharge, according to law, the duties of governor of the state of Connecticut to the best of your abilities, so help you God.
So help me God.
So she was able not only to regain her popularity in Connecticut, and at the same time take care of her political opponents, too.
After the storm was over, we contacted officials in other states to see how they were doing. It literally took Rhode Island and Massachusetts close to a week after we had cleared the roads for them to get their roads cleared. And it was basically a case of the governor's decision to close the highways and to beat up the White House to get federal help in. And it worked.
When the blizzard of 78 finally ended, there were 9 reported deaths in Connecticut. Most of the victims were seniors who collapsed after trying to shovel away the mounds of snow. New England, as a whole, fared much worse. There were 99 reported deaths. 1,700 single-family homes were destroyed, and 39,000 people were stranded or displaced.
There was never really a storm quite like that since 1978.
It was a week of nonstop, no sleep, reacting to situations as they arose minute by minute.
And in the morning, an assessment will be made.
If the storm were to threaten today, the state would be shut down sooner. In 78, there weren't really a lot of true believers that this was going to happen.
So many people did so much to prevent loss of life and to get an entire state back on its feet after it had been whacked in the worst possible way. It's quite an experience.